Thank you, thank you. And you remember last year I told you that I talked with my hands, so this doesn't really work well for me. So if just in case I go up and down, you'll know it's because I'm moving my hands. But the caregivers, I just want to see your hands again, those who were caregivers. Let me tell you what I did before I came, because when she said this about the caregivers, I wanted to just say something special to you today. So I wrote this out this morning, so just bear with me. Today, this is the longest day, and we celebrate the Alzheimer's disease. But it has been a lot of long days for you in caring for those that you love. You are the hero. You are the volunteer. You are the best of things, and often you are the worst of things, depending on the status of the person that you're caring for. You had to be all. You have to do all. You are the child, the daughter, the niece. You are the husband. You are the wife. You are everything to him or her, and without you, there are no days, no long days, no long nights. Without you, they can do nothing. No foundation do they have when you're not there. You are it for them, not a volunteer position that you elected to become a part of, not a place where you decide how many hours you're going to work today, not a volunteer that can say, I'm on my way out. I'm on my way home. I'm out for the day. But you continue to worry even when you leave. Your continued concern burns in your heart even when they are not in your sight. A continuous type of love, a continuous type of memory that you had before this dreaded disease snapped them from you. And when times arrived and you can't do it all, and there may come a time that arises when you can't do it all, you can't plan it all anymore. When and if you can't work and take care of that loved one, when and if you can't provide for your family or those that you care for, when you become the meat between the sandwiches, and we call it the sandwich effect, we call it that because you're caring for your children, your personal family, and then you're having to reach back and care for that loved one. You're caught between the best and the worst of two different obstacles in your life, but somehow you persevere, somehow you go on. And the reason I know, because I was a caregiver. Now, how many of you were here last year? Okay, well, how many were not here last year? Okay, well, then you're just going to have to work with us till the ones from last year get caught up with you. So you may hear some of the same similar things. Now, remember what happens. A lot of times when we develop this disease, and the disease was the disease that my mother had, we are in denial. And that's something that we must overcome first, because when my mother was having some difficulty with her memory, my father called me. Now, I may not have told you, but I was a bad, bad child. I was the worst of 8 children, and they never thought I would amount to anything. But I had 2 parents that loved me. I had 2 parents that prayed, and that's why I came out, and that's why I am where I am today. So just in case you have a child that has not reached that point yet, just give us a little time. We'll get it straight. But what was happening is that denial was there. I was a nurse. I was in home health care. I was seeing people with this dreaded disease. But when my dad called and said, hey, Ed, because he wanted a boy, and he said, Ed, I says, yes. He says, your mother turned every eye on in the kitchen, and then she went to the back of the house. Now, I'm from the South, okay, and we have a sense of humor there. And so I told her, I told him, are you down there in the kitchen where she just turned all the lights on? And he said, yes. I said, well, just cut them off. The next time he called, he said, Edna, he says, what's that little slip that you all have that you put on that's like a little cut-off type slip, and it's just the top? I said, you mean a camisole? He says, yes. He said, well, your mom just went to the mailbox and just had on a pair of pants and her camisole. Now, in Atlanta, we lived in a cul-de-sac. And they were up in age, and all of the other men were deceased. This is what denial will do for you. I said to him, has the mailman gone? He said, yeah, well, the only man up there is you, so what are you worried about? This is how denial kicks in. The next time he called, he said, Edna, I got up the other night, and your mother had left every door open in the house. I said, what time did you go to bed? Do you understand how the denial comes? Then you should have stayed up long enough to lock the house up. What happens with people who are in love, now they had been married probably 55, 56 years at this point. when there are couples, you're going to find out later on that somebody has a problem because they love each other. They've been finishing each other's sentences for a long time. My mother had 8 children, and I still didn't know when she was calling my name. But the way she looked, you knew which child she was talking about, so you just responded. So what happens is when people are like that, if they're going in the wrong direction, the other mate will say, you made the wrong turn. You need to turn around. And so they compensate for each other. So when you have couples that are married, it's more difficult for you to determine that something is wrong. Now, with the African-American population, one of the reasons that they remain in the household together is because for some of you who have had to place your loved one in a nursing home, your monies drop when you do that. So most often we try to keep them in the home for as long as they can so that you can keep the full amount of the monies coming into the home so that everyone can be cared for. Because if you haven't experienced that and you're a child with 2 parents, then this is what happens when one parent is placed in a nursing home. The funds go down. The other problem that we want to tell you about, and we're going to skip around so that we can hit every point and we can leave more time for questions and answers. The problem is that there's some things that you need to know before you have the diagnosis of Alzheimer's. Do we have any social workers here? Okay, as a social worker, I don't know what the time frame is in Michigan, but in Georgia, when you get the diagnosis, it needs to be 5 years before you start selling the house and everything else. Now, the reason I mention this is because I was doing home health care. Do we have any nurses in the audience? I was doing home health care, and I went to an area in a kind of poverty area in Atlanta. And when I went there, I was falling through the steps just to get to the person's house. And then I went to an area called Buckhead that's in Atlanta, where it's blue blood type of money out there. And I looked and I saw that this man had all of the services that were available. And then I looked at this lady and she had no services. So I went back to the office, and being militant as I used to be, I've kind of got a little better since I moved to Michigan and I'm at the U of M, but being from the South, being my age, you're just a little militant. You want questions answered. And they says, well, Edna, come on in the office, because they had to stop the scene that was about to take place, and let us tell you what happened. They said, the lady with the house, she owns the house. They don't ask you how much the house costs. She's just a homeowner, which means she's not eligible for the services that are there. But the man in Buckhead had put all of that stuff into his children's name, so he no longer owned a home. And so that's how the services are rendered. What happens, though, is that if, in fact, you're going to place your loved one in a nursing home, there are some things that you need to do before the diagnosis comes. And one of those is taking some of the things out of their name, placing it in someone else's name so that services are available. You can take that money if they didn't have long-term insurance, and most of our parents from the age that they were coming up, long-term insurance was not there. So they don't have any types of finances to take care of them if they remain at home. But if you did this and you acquired the funds, now you have the funds to take care of them while they are at home. So this is why the Bible tells us that we're destroyed because of a lack of knowledge. You need to have the knowledge so that you know the direction that you need to go. The other situation that occurs with Alzheimer's is that the places that you may want to put them are not up to par. And the young lady with AARP, Janice, can I have some water? That came with AARP. She gave you some instances as to what's out there for you. She spoke a little earlier this morning. You've got to know what's out there before you need it. When you need something and you began to look, you make unwise choices. If you already began to look before you need it, then you've already got things together. Now, an example of that, have you ever tried buying a new outfit and you try to find the shoes after you bought the outfit? It's harder than if you just had some shoes and then you bought an outfit and brought it home and said, oh, they match. So this is the same thing that you have to do when you're looking for health care, when you're looking for someone to take care of your parents. But the other thing that we have to realize now is that the age of onset is actually, let me go back, because if you weren't here last year, maybe we didn't discuss the different types of Alzheimer's and why you need to see a neurologist to get the correct diagnosis. Now, what determines the type of dementia you have is based on the part of the brain that's affected, okay? Now, if you look at Campbell's soup, and you've got Campbell's soup, and under Campbell's soup, you have maybe 25, 30 different soups that they make. So when you look at dementia is the umbrella, And under dementia, you have different types of cognitive impairment and movement disorders. Because a lot of the movement disorders, if they suffer with that movement disorder for a long period of time, it will eventually give you some of the same symptomology that presents with Alzheimer's. Now, you have frontal temporal, and that's when the front part of the brain is affected. There's no one in here that's in research, I don't think, but when you go through research, we ask you certain questions that are indicative of the type of behavior that the person is exhibiting. One of the reasons we want to know that, you remember the movie One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest? Remember when they used to do the lobotomies and they would take the frontal portion of the brain out and then their affect was just bland, there was nothing there? Well, when dementia affects certain parts of the brain, the frontal part of the brain where behavior takes place, this is when you will begin to see the inappropriate behavior. Sometimes with men, you will see them begin to sexually act out. With women, you might, somebody that has never cursed or done anything just starts cursing. So this is what happens when that part of the brain is affected. And then we have other parts of the brain that present what we call Lewy bodies, and that's something that's found in the brain. We not only have the plaques and the tangles that are found in the brain, and let me give you an example as to how a plaque and a tangle actually works. I'm going to talk loud to see if I can put this down. But the when you have a stroke, because believe it or not, can you hear me without using this? Okay, remember. In 1960s and 1970s, this disease was a Jewish disease. Do you remember that? They thought that it had something to do. People stopped using aluminum pots because they felt that it was the aluminum that they thought was in the brain. But then about the 70s and the 80s, it jumped over and became an African-American disease. We are number one for the diagnosis now. One of the reasons we're number one for the diagnosis is because we're number one for diabetes, we're number one for hypertension, and we're not number one for high cholesterol, but Caucasians have a higher cholesterol level, but we have the strokes. Do you see what I'm saying? So when you have a stroke, and I'm going to give you this analogy, this demonstration, and you can see it. If you were traveling on 94 and there's an accident, as soon as the accident takes place, you got all this rubbish lying in the street and everything. That's a symbol of the plaques and tangles that are in your brain when you have the stroke. Whenever the oxygen supply to the brain is cut off, you're going to lose some cells up there. And so what happens, the residual of that accident, those headlights and bumpers and everything that's lying on the streets, that becomes the plaque and tangle in your brains. So if something is trying to hit each other like so, if the neurons are trying to fire and we're firing head to head, if you have this trash in between there, it's not going to hit on the top. It's going to go to the side. When that information that you're receiving goes to the side, then you don't have the true story. What has happened is what we call confabulation. And so they make up parts that don't fit. And I think I may have shared this with you last year when I was telling you about my mother. She had been over to the house, and I like Law and Order. So I was watching Law and Order. And she went to church the next morning and was saying, "You all should have been over to Edna's house last night. Police were just everywhere. People were firing guns, everything was just all." And I'm going, "What is she talking about?" Because you know some of the saints wanted to believe that too. You see? So what happened is that it was Law and Order. That's what she saw. So when Alzheimer's developed, people cannot separate the reality from the fiction. They get a little of it and they call it confabulation, and everything they don't understand, they just make up along the way. And so what happens when this occurs in the brain, they can't come to where you are, you must go to where they are. Now, because you know the long-term memory remains, it's the short-term memory that goes first. This is why they can recall their mother, but they can't recall that she's deceased. They sometimes don't even remember who you are when they're talking. But what happens is that since they cannot come to where you are, you have to go to where they are. And I gave you this example last year about did I tell you about the older lady that thought she was pregnant, the one that was 86 years old? Okay, so she's 86 years old. And she's in Buckhead, and I'm in Douglasville. So in Georgia, that's about an hour distance from there to over there, but it's a straight shot. So her daughter called and says, "Edna, you've got to come out here. Mother's just up here. She's just this big disturbance." So now they got this big, long place with probably 20, 30 people sitting at the table, and it's her husband with all of his colleagues there at the place. So I went down there and I asked her, "What's happening?" And she said she was pregnant. Now she's about 86, and I told, now remember, they can't come to where you are. So you've got to go to where they are. So I told her, I said, "Well, come on, let's go upstairs." So understand now, their reality is not in sync like yours. I said, "What I need to do is get this baby, deliver this child and take this child on out of here, because everybody downstairs trying to figure out who dad is, because your husband been dead for about 15, 20 years. So what we do is we take the babe and we go on. And when I take her back down and sit down, her daughter says, I don't know what you did. And I told her, you really don't want to know. Do you see what I'm saying? So what happens is that because she can't come into the reality of things, if that's where she is, that's where you got to go. So we call it confabulation. But you must understand, you will never win an argument with a person that has Alzheimer's. So you may as well go on and join whatever is going on. And I told you about my mother and the dead people last year, okay? And every morning she got up and she fixed four bowls of cereal. She gave the four bowls of cereal to the dead people. Now, what we fail to ask a person, caregivers, because this is basically more or less for you, what you fail to ask the person is, what are you doing? It's a simple question. Just ask them, what are you doing? And wait until they tell you what they're doing. Well, her theory was that the dead people needed to eat. So we go on with that, because I can't change that. That's a fixed delusion. So when they say that you're stealing the money or you're doing all this, it's a fixed delusion. You will not be able to change that. So what you do is you join the delusion and then you bring them out of it. So what did I tell her? Well, the next morning I got up and I helped her fix the bowls of cereals too. But what I did tell her is that, you know, I think all the dead people need to eat too, but I think they need to go to their own folks' house and eat. Bam, and you've closed the gap there. So what you have to understand as a caregiver is that you've got to have a sense of humor, because you cannot be that intense every day. You cannot live like that. You cannot. And then sometimes you have to ask yourself, because they don't like to bathe and they really don't like to change clothing, who are you trying to make them bathe for, and who are you trying to get them to change their clothing for? Is it you? Because you feel like if somebody came around, they might. But does it really make a difference at this point? You've got to choose your battles wisely as a caregiver. You can't get into struggles over something that will not make a difference a few days after. And what you need to do as a caregiver is take the clothing out of the closet, because stimuli causes problems for people who have dementia. All those clothing, all those choices, how do I choose this and that? One pair of pants, one shirt. And who cares if you have to wet up all of the clothing if they don't want to pull their clothing off to take a bath? Let them keep the clothing on. What difference does it make? Just put the clothing in the washer, dry them, and you got them for the next day. But if they're not going to take their clothing off and they need to take a bath, go head on and do the whole thing together. And Janet sometimes laughs at me, because we're from the South and we didn't have a lot of pools down there. We didn't have a lot of water down there. And my mother came out, and she was a little nasty, and she hadn't wanted to take a bath in a while. So I was washing my car. I just turned the hose on her and did the whole wash off, and problem was solved. Do you see what I'm saying? It was a joke to her, because I think that long-term memory of how she used to spray us off in the summer months to kind of make the grass grow, it was a two-for-one. They were gonna put the water on the grass because it was too hot, and the children used to get out there and do this. So you have to understand that if there's anything in their long-term memory that you can salvage and ride on, then that's what you need to do when you're dealing with them. Now, most of the time, we don't want to treat our parents and our loved ones like their children. You must respect them as an adult, but you must monitor them as a child, because it's the same learning process that they're going through. Now, if you have children or grandchildren, remember, you could tell your grandchildren or your children to clean up that room, take a bath, and come downstairs and eat, and later on you go back and the room wasn't clean, and they were sitting at the table, and you tried to figure out what happened to the other two steps. In Alzheimer's, a person can only understand a one-stage command. One stage, not a three-stage command. And this is why when you come into research, Lillian, I don't know if they did this, but they'll give you a piece of paper, tell you to fold it in half and give it back to me. Well, the purpose for that is because I gave you a piece of paper. I said, take this piece of paper with your left hand, one, fold it in half, two, and give it back to me, three. That's a three-stage command. An individual with cognitive impairment will not comprehend that unless they're in the mild cognitive impairment phase. Once it gets to a certain extent, you must give one command at a time. You must allow them to take that message and transpose it into an action, which they cannot do with a person who has cognitive impairment. So this is what you say: Mom, yes, and you wait till she answers. Can you come downstairs? That's the command. And you wait until that is done. Now, if you're fast-paced, then you're the wrong person to deal with someone with Alzheimer's, because they're marching to a different drummer. And if you notice that your time is not their time, it's not going to be that way. If you get up and you got an appointment at 10, you need to get up at 5 o'clock. So that maybe you might be able to leave at 9. But getting up at 9:15, thinking that we're just going to rush and do it, it's not going to happen a lot of times. And so therefore, when you ask her to come downstairs, you let that go until she comes downstairs or until they come to the kitchen. Then you say, sit down, not at the table, just sit down. There's a chair there. And then you say, turn around to the table. That's the third. So each thing I wanted her to do, we had to wait until she completed a step at a time. If you do it that way, you think it might take longer, but in the end, it doesn't take as long as if you had said, you need to come into the kitchen, sit down at the table so you can get your food. Now, if they're not firing, if the neurons are not connecting, then what you've said just slid all to the side. So they may come down, they may not even sit. You'll see them come in and they're just standing there because they're trying to figure out what to do next. What happens when you're eating? Sometimes the memory of taking the fork, putting it into the food, and then taking the food to the mouth, that's gone. They don't understand that. So oftentimes they'll wait to do what you're doing. They'll wait to see what you're gonna do. So it's not bad to say, take the fork in your hand. You can stick that fork in your food. But now if you're sitting there waiting for them to do it and they've forgotten the process, and this is what happens in the way they dress. The same thing happens when they're dressing. You'll see that the slip may be on top of the dress or the pants maybe because they've forgotten the order of things, okay? The order is what is not, they know how to do everything you're asking them to do, but the order, the sequence is now gone. And so therefore you have to give them time to catch up to the things that you want them to do. You cannot be rushed. And I said it, and I really like to push this during the summer months because oftentimes the person feels a little better. It's a family reunion or a church reunion or something going on, and you want to take that individual with Alzheimer's to those affairs. It's more difficult because they cannot comprehend everything that's going down. The noise and everything just starts hitting, and it causes them to become agitated. And you'll notice sometimes they'll walk away. But other times they will become angry, they'll become fidgety, because they're in a place where all this noise, and for them it's like noise. Now there's an animation that a nursing home does where they put you on these things to mimic what it's like for someone with Alzheimer's. They change the eyesight, because people with Alzheimer's, they lose their peripheral vision. This is why you see falls associated with people. They cannot see when if the whole carpet is a particular color. This is why you want to put different colors, that not throw rugs, but you've got to change the color pattern in a household, because when they look at it, it all looks the same. And if there's a step that has the same type of carpet as the floor, then they're stepping like they're still stepping out on the floor, not stepping down. So depth perception is lost and peripheral vision is gone. And so therefore you can see why they don't know what's going on. You're showing them something thinking they're comprehending, but they don't comprehend what you're showing them. They may not even, they may lose the the ability to read. They may lose the ability to do a lot of the things that you thought they could do. And then you'll have some family members that say, oh, she's just acting up. She was just mean. And that's not really what it is. The person at this point does not know what the appropriate behavior might be for an appropriate situation. Going back to my mother at the church on Sabbath morning. We went to church that Sabbath morning, and I still took my mother to church because the long-term memory was there. She could still read the Bible. She could still quote scripture. She still knew the hymns, but she may not have known who I was. But I took her to church, the inappropriateness, and we're sitting there. Now, some of it was possibly true, but she said, right in the middle of service, he's been up there for the last 2 hours, and ain't said nothing yet. Can we just go home? So what I'm saying is that the reality of what she felt, she was on target. She was on target. And all I could do was say, well, let's just go. You see what I'm saying? And you walk on out, because there's no need in trying to stand there to defend what she said. There's no need for an apology, because he had been up there for a long time. So she was on target with that, but she was a deaconess. And down in the South, the little deaconess wear the little white dresses, and they all sit, you know, and the deacons over here. And so when she left out, all the little deaconess just got on up and walked out after. So, because she had diabetics that were there too, that were ready to, you know, he had been up there too long. You know, so what I'm saying is that if you have a sense of humor as a caregiver, you'll be okay. But if you're trying to play it straight, it's not going to work, because you're not dealing with somebody. And sometimes people make statements like, well, whatever they were is just intensified. That may be true because my mother always had a sense of humor, but socially she knew when to say what she was going to say. When she developed Alzheimer's, she became like I was when she was trying to take care of me. And that's what was hilarious about it, because there was nothing that my mother could do that would embarrass me. Because I was telling, what was that, the name of the church? Ebenezer, a couple of weeks ago. Sometimes when I'm talking about her, it just brings back memories. But, you know, I got put out of school quite often, you know. I just didn't like it, you know. So she would take me back to school and she would say, Edna, could you just go to the school? All you got to do is go to school, sit down, listen to what these people say. Do you understand? She would always end her little, you know, because I was just, she had said it so much until, you know, I was sitting down there, because I knew what she was going to say, could you just go? And so what happened is that there was nothing she could do that could embarrass me, because she always told me, do you understand how embarrassing it is for me to come up here in this man's office every Monday morning for something you did? Could you just go to school? So when she developed Alzheimer's, I felt the same way. There's nothing she could do that's going to embarrass me. It's nothing. And so as children to parents who develop this disease, you have to hold on and remember the type of person that they were. If you can hold on to that as a caregiver, nothing they do will distract you. Nothing they do will disturb you, because if you remember yourself and what they went through. Now, I made the statement that if you couldn't, when it gets to the point when the when if comes and you can't take care of them in the household, I understand that. But there were eight of us, eight children, and I was number 7 out of 8, and this about 8-9 years between me and between my younger sister and I. And she sat on the porch one day and she said, Edna, she said, you know what? Because I tell you, I was a bad kid, so I was at home for a long time. Every time I went out, I came back home. You know, every time something happened, I came back home. If I wanted a pair of shoes and didn't want to pay the light bill, I was back at home. She said, so this is the type of kid that I was. But we were sitting on the porch, but when I look back over the life, it was just as it was supposed to be. Because I was there when she became 65. I was there when she was 70. She was still coming over to the house trying to help a sister out. But what happened is that she said, "There, me and your dad have raised all 8 of you all, but there will come a time that the 8 of you all will not be able to take care of us." Now, she was a lady that had limited education, but she had a lot of wisdom. And I knew that from a young age, that her wisdom, you know, and what she told me when I started going to school is, yeah, you keep up, because I came home one day trying to tell her something. She said, you keep on, just keep on. She said, you know, it's nothing worse than an educated fool. So she kept us very humble. But that day when she made the statement that the 8 of us would never be able to take care of her, I didn't really know what she meant. I wasn't even thinking on that line. You know, most of you all who have parents, you're never thinking about the day that they won't be a parent. You never think at 20 that one day my mother's not going to be here, or that some, you don't think that way. But how many of you have more than one child? Let me tell you this. If you've got more than one child, you need a living will, okay? Because I was that bad child, but I had become a registered nurse at that time, and I'm also a social worker, okay? So I had gotten my life together. But you know, when you're that low on out of 8 kids, people don't let you forget the stuff that you've done, the tricks you played, you know, the money you've misappropriated. They don't let you forget that. So when something comes and it's time now to make that decision, because I knew my mom, that's the one thing that I knew. And she always told me, Edna, I can stay with, because I never stayed married. So what her deal was that, and I had 4 sisters that, you know, that stayed married to the same person. So what she says, but what she told me is she said, I got married sometimes, but not to the same person. So what she told me, and what she, because it didn't take much for them to leave. If you don't like the fact that my daddy's coming over and he got a key to the house, you got to go. So anyway, I grew up after my father's death. That's when the maturity actually set in. But anyway, she said, I can go and stay with any of my children as long as I'm up and about. But if I'm ever down on my back, you take care of me. Because see, what my mother saw in me was that love. What she saw in me was that, you know, out of all that other stuff that, there's a lot of stuff too, out of all that other stuff that I did, that's the one thing that she knew. Now, I had a son when I was 16, so it was not only me coming back and forth, but it was me and my son that were coming back and forth. Okay, but they loved him, and they showed him, like, for my father, let me just make this commercial since Father's Day was just Sunday. But when my father died, that's when maturity set in for me, because I was my father's princess, okay? And I got so depressed, and some of you caregivers, you're going to go through that when you're taking care of someone. when he was dying, because he died of prostate cancer. And after he died, I went into a spiral down. And I never will forget, my son came to me and he said, "You lost a father, but I lost a father and a grandfather." Okay, that's how much he was intermingled in our lives. But what happened is that after he died, the maturity set in for me. Now I've got to be this big girl. But before he died, he was telling me these stories about my mom. Do you understand? He was telling me that, you know, Edna, your mom did such and such. Edna, your mom. This was a year or two before he died. Now, when he was on the morphine drip, he told her, "My mother's name was Lula. My father's name was Ellie. In the South, her name was Duchy, and his name was Nuki." You have to be from the South to understand how those names come about. But the morphine drip was there. So I was at home. His hospital bed here, my bed right next to him. And he kept telling me that my mother needed to come and go with him. You know, we've been in this thing all along. You need to come on and go with me. And I told him one night, because he was in hospice, "This is not a two-for-one here. We've accepted the fact that you got to go, but we can't leave both of you." Because see, that's how the humor came in. It was less than 8 months after his death that she was diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. Okay, it was there all along. It had been there. But he protected her. You know, sometimes these people see, you know, not like me and maybe some other people, their love was a real love. Their connection and their obligation to each other, it was real. You see what I'm saying? I don't know if when they came and got me from the house, because I just shut down for about 2-3 weeks, I told my sister, she was saying, "You know, you got to snap out of this." And before I knew it, I said, "I never loved a man like that before." See, I didn't know any type of love but the type of love that my father had given to me. But that was the reason that we didn't know she was doing as bad as she was. Because his love for her kept that stuff private until he left. And so I do believe that there's social stressors that can exacerbate the disease. But nobody's giving us money for social research. Nobody's giving it. But there's some social factors for African Americans. We already know that we're number one for the diagnosis because of diabetes, hypertension, high cholesterol. Tell us something new. There's something else that's going on there. But when my mother did not tell anybody else what her desires were when she got to that point, but me and my son, then nobody knew. So when she got to the point where she needed assistance, she needed to go to the doctor, she needed medication, that's when the stuff started hitting the fan. You got one sister who says no. You got another sister who says yes. You got this brother saying no. You got this one saying she stays at home. This one says she goes to a nursing home. This one's on medication. And I'm sitting there going, this is what she wanted. But see, the relationship that I shared with my father, my mother unintentionally, that's why I say if you have more than one child, had intentionally raised me up, because when my father became ill, I was an RN, so I did all of his care for him. Instead of her just letting it go, you know how parents go and they was, "Well, you know, Edna was so helpful. Her dad didn't have to go to the doctor. She changed the catheter. She drew the blood." She didn't realize what that did until after his death. When we were in the hearse taking my mother's body to the gravesite, I told my sisters, you know, "If I've done anything, please forgive me. I never intended to do it this way. It was just that she told me some things and I was trying to make it right." And Janet can tell you, I lost connection with my son for 5 years because my son said, "You knew what she told you to do and you didn't do it." And he had a very serious problem with that. And I tried to explain to him that I couldn't take my sister to court because my mother wouldn't have wanted me to do that. So I was between what she wanted to do and then turning again on four sisters and three brothers that did not agree with what I wanted to do. If you have more than one child, don't put that child in that position. Now, we're all right now. My son is still a little distant, but it took some years. And like I tell you too, everybody needs a road dog, okay? And say, so I understand that, you know, there's a lot of education in this room and everything, but sometimes you need one of those friends that's just down to earth. Because it was a Saturday morning. Girlfriend called and said, "Edna, are you going to church today?" I told her, "I don't want to go to church. I want to see my mom." But I didn't want to cause any confusion because every time I came around, it was a fuss, it was a fight. I'd had to go through, I was 45 years old and I had never spent a holiday away from my parents. I had never gone away to school. I was always less than 3 miles from my parents. So you got to understand what this separation did. My dad's gone now, and my mother's been taken because she has Alzheimer's, and I can't even go to see her because they don't want me in their home. But I had a girlfriend, Shirley. That morning, you know, she said some four-letter words, but she said, it's your mother, and if you want to go see your mother, we're going to see your mother. And if we get there and they won't open the door, we'll call the police. But it's your right to see your mother. Do you understand the purpose of a living will now? Okay, we got there, and for some reason, everything was okay. But I found out when I saw my mother why everything was okay. I had not seen her in 6, 7, 8 months. When I came into the room, and this is what I'm telling you about Alzheimer's. When I came into the room, she was on a hospital bed. All she did was lift her hand up. And when I saw that tear, and that's why I'm telling you, there's windows of opportunity for these people that nobody knows what's going on in their head. I don't care what, I'm in the science field, I don't care what they say. There's some times that they know exactly what's going down. So I sat down with her and I said, hey mom, I said, I met this guy. I said, this seems like one that I won't have to take care of. Seems like he might be able to take care of me. He's from Michigan, and I went to Michigan for the Christmas holidays. I just went on and talked like she and I used to talk. And when I got ready to go, I bent down and I told her, you can go now. And she died 48 hours later. Do you understand what I'm saying? She waited. Do you understand? Because see, she was already in hospice, and I didn't realize that. Do you understand? There are times. Okay, there are times that, you know, that they know what's going on. But like I'm saying, when I came in there, because she and I were a lot alike, and that's what I found out after her death through some of the things that have taken place, okay? But when I told her, when I whispered to her and told her, you can go now, you have to understand when it's time to let go. Sometimes people are holding on for you to give them permission to let go. There's dignity in letting go. As a caregiver, you must be able to say, it's okay. You can go now. Because in my father's death, I learned that. Because one day, he would never eat unless I came over and prepared the food. And he looked at me one day and he says, baby, I don't want to eat anymore. You know, it's worse on me to eat than if I didn't eat. And I know I went in and told my mother that, and she broke down. Because at that point, he was telling me, I'm ready to check out of here. I'm ready to go. Sometimes when people have dealt with Alzheimer's, you don't really die from Alzheimer's. You die with the symptomology associated with Alzheimer's. Do you see what I'm saying? But people keep holding on. Trust me, there's some people that are ready to go, and they're holding on until you can let them go. You must know as a caregiver when it's time to let go. When your responsibilities are now finished, when it's okay to say, I fought a good fight, but I finished this course. You understand what I'm saying? And so therefore, as a caregiver, you must understand when they say to leave me alone or to let me go. And you can see it almost. If you know your parents, you can kind of look into their eyes. And it's hard, people, to look into the eyes of someone, because even before they began to do what they were doing, it was the wrong thing to do. There were 5 girls, so they decided that she would spend 3 months at each person's house. Person with Alzheimer's does not need to be moved. They're already confused. And so every time she moved in another 3 months, she had to try and relearn. But this is another social implication. When I was trying to raise that son by myself, I was trying to potty train him. And I was getting a little stressed out, and she could tell it. And she came into the bathroom one day, because this is, you know, sometimes I wish people knew my mother, but she says, honey, you can't teach that boy how to use the bathroom. You don't even have what it takes to teach him. Okay? So what I did, so what she did is she sat him down and she traced his little feet, put it on Velcro. The little feet went to the bathroom. That's how my son used the bathroom. He was so excited about running after his little feet and then jumping on the commode, okay? So when she came to my house and she could no longer remember where the bathroom was, I sat her down, I cut her feet out, I put them on the Velcro, and she was able to go to the bathroom. Sometimes you have to understand as a caregiver that you've got to try to figure out what's wrong. Remember when you had children that you checked them to see if they were wet. You checked to see if they were hungry, and then you administered to those needs. People with Alzheimer's cannot tell you when they're in pain. If in fact they have dentures or if they've got food in their jaw, they can't tell you that that food is there. You've got to put your finger in their mouth that night. You've got to be able to see that. They can't tell you if the dentures are fitting ill. Think about the things that you've had problems with that nobody knew but you. And you remedied the situation. They can't tell you if they're constipated. So if you're not watching their bowel,